among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all of his wonderful works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength, seek his presence continually. Remember the wonderful works he has done, his miracles and the judgments he has uttered. O offspring of his servant Abraham, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. Then Israel came to Egypt. Jacob lived as an alien in the land of Ham, and the Lord made his people very fruitful and made them stronger than their foes, whose hearts he then turned to hate his people, to deal craftily with his servants. He sent his servant Moses and Aaron, whom he has chosen, that they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Praise the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second lesson is from Romans. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel.
Between Peter and Jesus, right, with the question, who do you say that I am? Jesus asks. And we were able to reflect on that question. Jesus isn't so interested in who others say Jesus is, even though they respond to that, right? Some say you're Elijah, some say you're like one of the great prophets, some say you're John the Baptist, the disciples tell him. Jesus doesn't seem to care about what other people say about him. Jesus is concerned about one thing and one thing only, and that is, who do you say Jesus is in your life? Who do you say that I am? Jesus asks his earliest disciples, and Jesus asks us that as well. Who do you say that I am? And then, what does that look like? Jesus talks about a cross in Matthew's passage this morning, doesn't he? He talks about taking up crosses. Well, what does a life look like when we take up our crosses? When I was ordained into Word and Sacrament ministry now a couple years ago, my mother bought me a pewter cross, a pectoral cross that I would wear around my neck as a sign of my calling. Is that what it means to wear a cross? Is that what it means to take up our cross? Is to wear a cross so people might know our identity as Christians? I lost that cross the beginning of this summer. That beautiful pewter cross. I brought it to Synod Assembly in St. Peter, and I was going to loan it to one of my colleagues in the ministry, Kurt Messick, and so I handed the cross to him, my cross. That meant a lot to me, and he said, well, I usually don't wear a pectoral cross, and so I remember taking it back and putting it somewhere, but I can't quite remember where I placed that cross. How many of you have crosses on this morning? So what does that mean for you? Or what does that mean for others who see you? I know some of you like to make lists of things, right? Things to do, good things to do. How many of you have lists, little pieces of paper lying around your house with important and good things for you to do, right? I mean, so you're reminded of those things so that you're motivated to get those things on the list done. They say that there are two types of people in the world. Those who like lists, things to do lists, and those who don't like things to do lists, right? Those are two. I think there are three people in the world. Those that make lists, to-do lists, those that don't make to-do lists, and those that make to-do lists for other people, right? So there are three types of people, right? And we've all seen to-do lists from other people. What do we call them? We call them honey-do lists, right? Honey-do lists. But we make our lists. Sometimes we might write them down on sheets of paper, and then we can cross those things off. Or maybe some of us just make lists in our minds of things that we wish to accomplish, right? And so as we accomplish them, there is a sense of fulfillment. But there's always another list, right? There's always another day. Thinking of this might be, for those of you who maybe don't like lists, this might be a good thing for you to think about. There is a website, and it's entitled Three Good Things. How many of you have heard of that? Three Good Things. And so it's an exercise that you would do at night. Well, you time, actually. But in just your day-to-day activity, you know, when things, some things go right and a lot of things go wrong, and we live with many disappointments, we live with many frustrations and grief and despair, this is a list that you think of in the past day of three good things that happened to you in the past 24 hours. And you write those down. Three good things. A list of three good things that happened in your life. And they had, like, psychologists and psychiatrists study people who actually did this. That every day they wrote three good things that happened to them during the course of the day. And they reported more happiness. They reported more life satisfaction. It's not that things really changed for them in their day-to-day living. It's just that the list of three good things offered them an opportunity to remember those good things and to celebrate that and to rest in those good things. So maybe that's a list, three good things that you want to attempt, right, in the coming days. We all make lists of things, right? And what does it mean to take up the cross? What does it mean to be a follower, a disciple of Jesus? What does it mean to answer the question in our lives, this question of Jesus, who do you say that I am? The Apostle Paul, and maybe you just want to grab your Bibles and turn with me to the 12th chapter of Romans that Mark read. The Apostle Paul was really a list maker. He loved lists. He had lists of what made him a great apostle. He had lists of all of the spiritual gifts that we're bestowed with. And this morning, we have a list, a long list, before us of perhaps what makes a disciple and what it means to take up our cross and follow Jesus. Beginning with verse 9, here is the list. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lack in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. How are you doing with the list in your life? How are you doing with the list? Bless those who persecute you. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. How are you doing with the list? Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. And if it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, and I will repay, says the Lord. Now if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So this is Paul's list to us on how we are to live in the Christian faith, and really what it means to take up our cross. It doesn't mean just to wear a cross, but it means to live selflessly in this world and to put others before ourselves. That's a true disciple. So how are you doing with your lists? Let's see. We've got to fold the laundry, right? We've got to do the dishes. We've got to, you know, clean out the dishwasher. We've got to run to the pharmacy. Rejoice in all things. And then we add these lists to our plate as well, which are larger than those day-to-day tasks, aren't they? But it's what it means to be a follower. It's what it means to take up our cross and to reflect the image of Christ. How about when we bring children to the baptismal font and we baptize them like we did today for Bolden? What about the list that is there in our service for baptism that we can all remind ourselves of? To be with God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and to come to the Holy Supper, to remember the Lord's Prayer and Creed and the Ten Commandments, to be reading Holy Scriptures and to nurture ourselves in faith and prayer so that we might learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made and to work for justice and peace. So that's a long list as well. You know, in some days we might be pretty good at that list. Other days we might struggle a little more with that list. But nonetheless, when Paul made this list, I can't help but he was thinking of the one, Jesus Christ, who did all of these things for you and for me, who took up the cross in love for you and in love for the world. This one, this Jesus Christ, who we gather in his name, and the one who continues to call us to his table so that we might be fed and nurtured in the faith, so that we might live a sacramental life as we remember baptism and Holy Communion, and as we partake in these things in our lives, and the one who receives us, even with all of those lists that we make that go unchecked, all of those things that we don't get accomplished, right? This Jesus sees us who we really are, and he still invites us to come to his table of love and grace, and to receive a blessing so that we might go out into the world with a renewed sense of our mission, with a renewed sense of who Jesus is and where we see Jesus in the world, and with a renewed sense of our commitment to be a follower of him, to take up our